marching band hat that had a big hit on it. It must have been part of their marching band, but old like. Wow.
First, we have birthdays. Willa and second week in a row, Holden Sybil, who was birthdays this week, not last week, though I had him in last week. So any other birthdays we should raise up? And Willa, you're here. All right, let's do happy birthday. Sunday, we have communion, and after church, we have a board meeting, and we have United Methodist Women. So, anybody who'd like to participate in that circus, feel free. We have an annual meeting coming up on the 11th with the other churches in our region, up at North Highland, and that'll be from 3 to 4:30 on the 11th. That's the time when we review annual reports and things. It used to be we had, each one of us had our own meeting and talk about things we had done over the year, and the district superintendent would cheer us on or chew us out. I never had them chew too hard, but I think most of them began to realize that they're lucky that people are in the church and doing things. Anyway, it's different now. It's kind of a group meeting, and it's just kind of a different experience. Everybody's welcome to go to it if you wish, but we have to get reports finalized, which we'll do next Sunday. And we've had some changes in our leadership committees, things like that. And slight changes in budget, though not much. Used to be we made huge things out of all of this, but a lot of it's just a matter of getting the paperwork done. That's on the 11th. The meeting to prepare for that is after church on next Sunday. Also, next Sunday, what's the theme for that, Kathy, for UMW? Is that one? I should know. I'm doing the program, but I don't remember. What? Oh, a thank offering. Makes sense. Thanksgiving. Thank offering. Okay. Anything else? Any other announcements? Okay, well, let's stand, take a few moments, then move about, and greet and welcome each other to this time of worship.
Good to see you, buddy.
This is the season of Pentecost, the time when we emphasize the movement of the Spirit in the early church and in our own time. The Spirit calls us to walk with Jesus.
And in the Lord, to worship God.
Our first hymn is appropriate for Reformation Sunday, number 110, The Mighty Fortress is Our God.
Come upon the earth. Amen.
let's take these next several minutes and spend them in prayer. Eternal God, in our gathering, we bring with us the joy of the gathering and the time spent together, and the joy of new life that's getting a more solid foothold as each day goes by, thinking of little and no one. We appreciate the healing that takes place in our lives when we are down, offering thanks that Robbie's eye is getting better, that Phyllis has gotten better enough to actually be able to take care of him. We offer thanks for the blessing we have of family. Opportunities to be together. We offer our gratitude for the gift of life, which so often we take for granted. We pray for those people whose lives have been upended these last few days, especially, and pray that in the midst of the death and violence, thinking of Pittsburgh, that won't result in bitterness or unrequited anger. And we thank you that these people are making the effort to reject the idea of revenge or bitterness. We can learn so much from them, even in their grief, as we pray for them in their grief. We've had many people before us in our prayer time over the months, many of whom have been before us for a long time. We continue to pray for them, to pray for healing, but most of all to pray for peace of mind and heart and soul, that whatever life, whatever happens in our lives, their lives, won't be overwhelming, but will be something they can face with confidence and with strength given by you. In this season, we approach Thanksgiving time, and we know that the best Thanksgiving is that given year-round. We approach a time of election, and we pray that in the midst of all of the campaigning and the bitter fighting, that afterwards we can actually function as one people in the best interest of our country and those others who depend on us and want to work with us. Remind us that as your people, we are one in your spirit. And hear us as we continue in prayer together. O God, who can make all things new, we bring before you this day the record of our lives. Where we have fallen short, forgive us. Free us from brooding over what is past. Help us this historic day to be open to reformation in our personal lives and within your church. Your truth by your mercy, and as by your truth, fill us with your hope. Lead us forever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us. not under temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Okay, today, I was telling Kathy about what I was thinking of doing today, and she said, oh my heavens. I said, normally my sermon is about like this, sometimes one side of the page. Today it's like this, on two sides of the page. I was thinking of just saying, well, you know, this is Reformation Sunday, and jumping into it, but when you get to looking at it, there's a lot more. I mean, there's really a lot there that we ought to at least be aware of for a while. By way of introduction, I would say, when I was at Dakota Wesleyan, Governor Mills Bowe's sister was one of our English teachers. Now, she lived alone, she was getting older, and she was an interesting person. She usually was thinking so far ahead of herself that she seldom finished one sentence before she was starting in on the next. It was an interesting thing to see. One day she did complete a sentence when she said, well, all I have to say is there's a lot to be said. Which I thought was neat. I mean, it stuck with me, didn't it? I mean, that's been a long time ago. But she was right on that point. Well, all I would say is there's a lot to be said, so here we go. The gospel reference today is Romans. Now, I'm not going to read the whole book of Romans, which probably should evoke a proud of you. Yeah, there you are. But Romans was really a pivotal letter from the Bible for both Luther and Wesley's. And Luther was pivotal for the Wesley's. And having grown growing up in what was essentially a Presbyterian and Lutheran family. Became a Methodist, the far more liberal wing of the family. Mostly because my mother, being a Presbyterian, had a big argument with my dad's Lutheran pastor, so we're Methodists. Late January 1738, after successful evangelism preaching in England, George Whitfield set sail for Georgia. And about the same time, John Wesley was returning from Georgia, having a totally failed mission outreach effort. And as he was heading home, he was pondering, "I went to America to convert the Indians, but who shall convert me?" About a year earlier, Charles Wesley became quite ill in Georgia, and he returned to England. John and Charles stayed in London at James Hutton's family home. On February 7, 1738, Hutton took the Wesleys to the home of a man by the name of Wynance, a Dutch merchant, to meet a group of Moravian Christians who had just arrived that day in London en route to America. The pastor of this group was a 26-year-old, gifted, and highly intelligent man by the name of Peter Bowler. John Wesley was despairing, found little comfort in his religion, didn't have the faith to continue to preach. To this new Moravian friend, Peter Bowler, he confessed his growing ministry and decision to give up ministry. But Bowler was convinced that John didn't have a personal trust in Christ. He said, "It isn't that you can't be a good minister. You got to relax a little bit and go with the flow of the gospel and the Christ." He didn't have a personal trust in Christ, but was open to the way of faith, Bowler said. Another thing he says, you have this need to explain everything in terms of logic. Every new idea that comes across your mind or your desk or something, you have to address logically and beat on it until you figure it out. And he says you have to set that aside. You're not going to solve it. You can't do it by yourself. It isn't that important, actually. In a month, Bowler had convinced Wesley of his unbelief that by faith alone we are saved, and thought, "Well, we're making progress." Well, John said he should stop preaching since he lacked true faith. Now, we have this mythology that's gone through Methodism for a long, long time. Wesley was this firm, basic, simple believer, a man driven by his faith and his need to convert people, and on and on. This guy was so distraught he could finally find his way out of a small room. So Bowler said, "So you think you don't have strong enough faith? Preach faith until you have it. Just keep at it until it finally sinks in. Then, because you have it, you will preach faith." That became one of Wesley's primary. One of the things he hung a lot of his life on: preach faith until you have it. And I think he knew that all preachers at one time or another are going to go through those dark times, those dark days, those doubtful times. But they didn't get there because they didn't have faith. So preach faith until you have it again, or have it the first time. And then because you have it, you will preach it. So John was encouraged, preached faith in Christ alone. He went to a jail and talked to an inmate, preached Christ to him, gave him Christ, who converted instantly. John was astonished. "What, really?" He'd struggled for years. It took him a long, long time. This man was converted instantly. Further, a New Testament study showed John that the longest delay in salvation was 3 days, those being the days while the Apostle Paul, who had been knocked to the ground and blinded, 3 days while Apostle Paul waited for his eyes to see again. The Moravians assured John that their experience had also been like that. quite instantaneous. So John prayed, "Lord, help my unbelief," and still he felt dull within, unable even to pray for his own salvation. On that day, May 24th, 1738, this man was an inveterate journalist. Everything he did was in a journal. So he even gets some of these entries where the time of day was entered. And here we are 200 and some years later with that information. But on May 24th, 1738, John opened his Bible at 5 a.m. We had a seminary professor one time that said, "Sloth has no place in your lives as pastors. After all, John Wesley got up at 4 or 5 every morning." And somebody from the back of the room said, "Yeah, and he's dead." Anyway, he opened his Bible at 5 a.m. to these words: "There are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, even that ye should be partakers of the divine nature." He read similar words in other places. That evening, he very reluctantly decided to attend a meeting in the chapel at Aldersgate. Interesting. He gets the time and the exact dates, but he didn't know the name of the person who read from Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans. "Someone," he said, "read from Luther's preface to Rome." John wrote about 8:45 that night, as Luther's preface described the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, "I felt my heart strangely warm. I did trust in Christ alone for salvation. I knew he'd taken away even my sins, saved me from sin and death." It took John time to learn how to live the life of faith, to realize it isn't good works, but Christ alone saves, which in turn results in those who are saved doing good works. And the writer of the passage said, in time God used John to reform England. His gospel, short little sentence, made this gigantic impact. Wesley had grown up in Rats, I forgot the name of the town. It was northeast of London. And his father was a Church of England priest, and they had all kinds of children all over the place. And his dad was a radical preacher, not necessarily liberal or anything, but had little patience. And he preached with such zeal that one time the parishioners stormed the house and set it on fire. I think, by and large, that's why most Methodist churches with parsonages own the parsonage. They're not likely to burn their own house down. Anyway, John was used to reform England. In the preface to Paul's letter, Martin Luther said these things briefly. "This letter is truly the most important piece of the New Testament, its purest gospel. It's well worth a Christian's time to memorize it word for word, to spend time with it every day as if it were the daily bread of the soul. It's impossible to read or meditate on this letter too much. The more we're immersed in it, the more fresh it becomes, and the better it tastes. Therefore, I offer these explanatory notes and comments so that everyone can gain the fullest understanding of it. We find in this letter the richest possible teaching about what Christians should know, the meaning of law, gospel, sin, punishment, grace, faith, justice, Christ, God, good works, love, hope, and the cross. We learn how we're to act toward everyone, the virtuous and sinful, the strong and the weak, friend and foe, and toward ourselves. Paul bases everything firmly on Scripture and proves his points with examples from his own experiences, from the prophets, so that nothing could be more desired. Therefore, it seems that in this letter, Paul summarized all Christian evangelical teaching, adding, whoever takes his letter to heart possesses the light and power of the Old Testament as well. Christians should habitually, constantly study this letter. God grant us the grace to do so." On the cover of our folder today is that picture all of us have seen before, Luther nailing the theses to the chapel door at Wittenberg. It's been said that Luther didn't actually nail them to the door, but still the image is captivating. It wasn't an angry protest against the church, but a call for public discussion. Such notices were frequently attached to the church doors, where people would see them. He also mailed them to his archbishop, together with a treatise on indulgences and a cover letter dated October 31, 1517, the date remembered as the beginning of the Protestant Reformation. Now, Luther was a professor at the university in Wittenberg. He announced this meeting for his students and others for helpful, critical debate of these theses, that he might clarify his own thinking. Even he didn't favor all 95. He was the town preacher with pastoral responsibilities for the laity of Wittenberg. He just thought these things should be raised and talked about. One issue that he really was firmly wrapped up in was that of indulgences, which he believed were harmful to his people, to his parishioners, to everybody. The church in those days taught that an indulgent is a way to reduce the amount of punishment one has to undergo after death for life's sins. And the more you paid in, the greater your chance of less punishment. This pious monk, Luther, believed the Pope didn't like using indulgences and forgiveness of sin into turning it into a marketing scheme at the expense of the people. But at the time, he didn't know that the Pope and the Archbishop were making money on this. They split it. They got half. One got half, the other one got half. So it's no surprise that the events took a turn that Luther didn't expect. Over 5 years, this devout monk concluded that obedience to God comes ahead of obedience to the Pope. And a split in the church took place. 501 years later, today, the church still faces issues that might divide it as we, United Methodists, know. We have a special general conference coming up in February to deal with issues, and nobody has a clue what's going to happen for sure. On October 31st, 1517, Luther's pastoral concern was primary. He believed true penitence meant judging ourselves in light of the Word of God. He thought indulgences were too easy. Not only were they breaking people financially, but they were too easy. Just pay up. Your sins are forgiven. Don't worry. Be happy. It was a time of grim religion. All law, little gospel. Protestant alternatives didn't exist in 1517. Luther had to find a word of God that was not an accusation, but rather a gift of grace and forgiveness. He found it in the sacraments of the church, which God uses to communicate grace to the people of God. Luther insisted that the sacraments were stronger than the Pope or the church, especially the hierarchy. December 1518, he taught people that the sacraments absolve you of all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. People should simply believe their sins are forgiven. This is heavy stuff. Still, in our day, some resist it. It's too easy. Cheap grace minimizes sin. Or some people, even pastors, have implied to me, especially your sins. So we keep judging, we keep heaping guilt, we keep heaping guilt on people for their sinful nature. And Pete Seeger saying, "When will they ever learn?" 1518. 2018. Protestantism got its footing on Romans 10:17. Faith comes by hearing. For Luther, everything depends on hearing the Word of God, taking hold of it, clinging to it, not denying its truth by talking back or arguing with God. His doctrine of justification is based on the conviction that God is true. It's the power of the Word of God that saves us. It gives us Christ, forgiveness, grace, righteousness. Gospel includes any scripture telling of the story of Christ given for us, be it even from the prophets or the apostles, such as Isaiah announcing, "For unto us a child is born." Or Paul teaching that nothing can separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus. Christmas Day, 1519, Luther preached that all the gospel stories are a kind of sacrament. Signs through which God brings about in those who believe whatever the story designates. That's why the story of Christ differs from other history. In the Gospels, the life and deeds of Peter, John, and Mary offer only examples of righteousness and virtue. The story of Christ gives us righteousness, virtue, and salvation. It signifies, just as baptism gives us new birth, because we receive by believing. The story is Jesus Christ himself. On Christmas Day, we can, in effect, come to the stable and say to Mary, "This baby is mine also. For unto us is born." Luther taught that it's by faith alone that we are united with Christ. When asked, "Am I doing well enough?" his answer, "Not well enough to save you from damnation." No act of our free will can obligate God to save us a seat in heaven. You owe us, God. We've been really good people. Even our decisions for Christ are not worth more than trusting God for our salvation. I believe, still I pray, help me in my moments. Every Christian. We cannot know people who are wiser and better than we, or worse, if we're unwilling to listen to them. Listen to what they say about themselves. Then we know and trust them. It's an appropriate reminder. This is not only Reformation Sunday, it's also United Nations Day. Some would say that the United Nations is tool of socialism, tool of the devil, tool of whatever. But it is an opportunity to know people and come to trust them and understand them. In a world in tumult as individuals or nations, we must not choose to cast one another out or cast stones in the form of insults or hatred or war. We must respect all of our human family enough to take time for them, to listen, to feed, to comfort after the fashion of our Lord Jesus Christ. Luther wished only to hear God speak, for it's in God's word that God is known. We can trust in the coming of God's kingdom by hearing God's word and Jesus' promise. All manner of things shall be well. And you shall see yourself that I shall keep my word and make all things well. How best to know God, listen, and hear Jesus' word and deed. Many preachers overlook the distinction between law and gospel, thinking they can change people's lives by giving them logical, practical advice, the way Whistler was wrestling with it in the 1700s. As if telling them how to be inwardly transformed could help them do it. Luther said, instead of advice, we can give people Christ in word and example, in action, in how we love, in how open we are, how listening we are, in the way we treat others. others as individuals, as political groups, as religions, races, denominations. You think of that in terms of the of violent mailings going to people this week, or a Jewish community attacked in our own day and age within the last few hours by somebody who still hates Jews. I mean, all this stuff is speaking to that very kind of a situation. It's as up to date as it was in Luther's time and Wesley's time. Luther said we can give people Christ in the way we treat them. For that in his life, for that in John Wesley's life, and for the resulting Methodism and its sisters and brothers this day, we can say, thank you, Martin. Glorious God, source of joy and righteousness, enable us as redeemed and forgiven children evermore to rejoice in singing your praises. Grant that what we may sing with our lips, we may believe in our hearts, and what we believe in our hearts, we may practice in our lives, so that being doers of the word and not hearers only, we may receive everlasting life. Now, I know just a couple weeks ago we sang This Is My Song, but hard not to use it on United Nations Day, so we'll sing again today. This Is My Song, 437. Let's stand and sing together. Church. not only here but around the world, which we'll do at this time, by receiving our morning offering. And after the offering is brought up, our prayer is the covenant prayer in the Wesleyan tradition. It's on the insert in your bulletin.
God's gift of Christ is shown
stone on our path and lights our way.
Wherever we go, when we leave this place, may all we do bring Christ's light and all the lives we touch. Amen. Amen.
Which is funny. States where somebody, and somebody waited for the cause and somebody played right through. This happens with my crowd. The last time we see there's one. And my card is placed right in this
It's